Is your calendar feeling a little chaotic and messy? Well, don't fret, because in this video, I'm going to walk you through 7 simple steps you can take to a more optimized and organized Google Calendar. Hello, everyone. Scott Friesen here at Simpletivity, helping you to get more done and enjoy less stress. And let's get started with tip number 1 and do a little bit of cleanup. I want you to come over here to the left-hand side, and I want you to expand your My Calendars section. I also want you to expand, if it's not already, your Other Calendars section. And now is the ideal time to review all of the calendars that may be sitting here, some which you've created, perhaps some that others have shared with you, or perhaps some others that you have subscribed to. And we want to either delete or, at a bare minimum, hide the calendars in this particular area. Anything that you're not using or will not be needing in the near future. So, for example, as I do a quick scan, I may notice that I've got pickleball and softball league. These are both things that I was doing back in the spring, and I no longer need them on my calendar. So I've got 2 choices I can make. So, for example, maybe with my pickleball calendar, I know this is done. This is over, so I'm going to say unsubscribe. I'm hovering over the X and I'm going to unsubscribe. It's going to give me a prompt to make sure I want to proceed. I'm going to say remove that calendar. But with the softball league, perhaps I recognize that this is the same link or the same calendar we're going to be using next spring. I've got another option available to me. If I come over here to the More options and click, I can choose Hide from List. Now, what this is going to do, it's going to remove it here from my calendar section. You may also notice that I had 2 events on the screen in front of me that were related to it. They have been removed as well. So it's hiding all of it, not only the list, but anything that was on the calendar, but I can still go back and re-enable it or activate it later on. If I come up here and click the gear icon and then select settings, if I scroll down to the left-hand side, here you can see that that softball league calendar still exists. If I click on it, I've got all of the different settings, everything else here that I can tweak, but I have this little crossed out eye, meaning that it is currently hidden. I've got a few others that are hidden here as well, maybe things that I want to use again in the future. So you'll have to make the best decision for yourself, but I strongly encourage you to review each of your calendars here and decide if you need them anymore, if not, delete them, and if you want to bring them back later, you can simply hide them. Now for step 2, we want to stay with this My Calendar section for a moment and make sure that we have a clear distinction between these different calendars, especially when it comes to color, because nothing is more confusing when you're looking at something on your calendar thinking, oh, I know what this is for or what this is related to, when really it's attached to another calendar. So for example, you'll notice that I have both a family calendar and I also have a work calendar, but they're both colored in red. That means if I create a family event or a family activity, I might confuse it with a work activity. Well, that doesn't make sense. So if I come here to the More options again on family, I'm going to choose this yellowish color so it stands out that it is distinct. But you may also want to look at opportunities where it can be valuable to have the same color. So for example, if my primary calendar, which will always be listed first, in my example, I have it named Scott's calendar, if it is primarily for work and other big projects, and then I've got a separate calendar for big spring project, maybe it makes sense if they are both purple. For example, because these first 2 are both work-related, I could always hide my first one and just see the events that are related to this big project. It's already work-related, that's why I've kept it the same color, but I can still toggle them on or off if I want to zero in a particular category. Now, step number 3 in our optimized journey is all about creating templates. In particular, creating recurring or repeating events that you want to take place either every week, every month or some other interval. This is most helpful to make sure that you stay on track and that you fulfill certain commitments, especially if these are things perhaps outside of work. So for example, maybe I've made it a goal that I want to have a date night with my wife each and every Friday night. But if I just wait until, you know, Wednesday to talk to her about it or think about it, it's not going to happen. But if I block out time and make it recurring, that drastically increases my chances of making it happen. So you can do this for either personal or professional or other events. What I'm going to do is I'm going to come to my Friday, and maybe I'm going to click at 7 p.m. and I'm going to just call this date night, nice and simple here. I am going to come down here and change the calendar because this is family or personal related. And before we click save, I want to change the repeat option. So instead of leaving this as does not repeat, I want to click on this and I'm going to say weekly on Friday. Now you don't have to select one of these defaults. If none of these fit your particular recurring event, you can come down to custom and choose something else. But in this example, date night, I want it to happen weekly on that Friday. I'm going to say weekly on Friday, and it's going to last more than just 1 hour. Let's put 2.5 hours in there. I'm going to hit save. We can always come in here and edit each one individually if I want to come in here and say what we are doing that Friday. But now as I go into the future, that date night is always going to be waiting for me there on that Friday. So think of other things in your life. It could be exercise, it could be meeting up with friends, it could be a weekly review or something else that is related to your business or related to your work, but create a few templates so that you remember the important things and that they come first in your schedule. Now, if you're enjoying this video so far and are wanting more tips to stay organized and optimized with Google Apps, why not subscribe right here to the Simpletivity channel? Each week, I give you new tips and tricks so that you can go from overwhelmed to organized and work at your productive best. Now, step number 4 is all about editing our notifications because there are few things that make us feel more overwhelmed than getting more notifications than necessary or not getting a notification when we need it. So in order to do this, we want to come up to our gear icon. Once again, we are going to select settings, and then we want to come down to our specific calendars because we want to adjust this on a calendar by calendar basis. There may be some calendars which we never want to receive a notification, and then there may be other calendars where we will want to receive multiple notifications. So I'm going to start with my main calendar here. This is probably going to be the most important one for most of us. And then about halfway down, we've got 3 different notification settings. If you click on event notifications, you're actually going to see all 3 of these headers. Now, the first one is event notifications. So when do you want to receive an alert? And yes, these will apply on both your desktop, but also your mobile device. Now, by default, mine here is set for 5 minutes before, but what if that's not enough? Maybe I want to stretch this out to 10 minutes in advance, but you also don't have to limit yourself to simply one notification. Maybe I want to add a second notification, I don't know, maybe 30 minutes out, or we have another option here to send an email notification. Now, I wouldn't recommend this maybe for your primary calendar. Maybe there's something else specific here, such as a family calendar, or perhaps something that you don't use as often where you will want to receive an email notification. But just don't forget that you have that option available to you. You can actually add up to as many as 5 notifications here within this setting here, but I would rarely recommend you using more than just 2. And if you need to remove it, you can always hit this X on the right-hand side. Don't forget, you're also not limited by minutes. You could send this out hours, days, or even weeks in advance, depending on the particular calendar. Next up, we have all-day event notifications, and these are for things such as a vacation or a day off or some other special event, which you are capturing at the very top of your calendar. So once again here, we can choose the type of notification, whether it's an email or if it's simply an alert. And because these are somewhat different, you probably want to receive these at a different time. You certainly don't want to receive this just a few minutes before. That's why minutes is not even an option here. You don't want to receive this at 11:55 p.m. for an all-day event, but I've got mine set for one day before at 5 p.m. And yes, you can adjust the time here as well. So how far in advance do you want to know of a vacation or a birthday or maybe a travel day? Think of how you use all-day event notifications, and you can make that adjustment here. Lastly, under other notifications, we have five additional ones that you can set up, whether it's for new events, changed or canceled events, or event responses. Most of these have to do when it comes to meetings, when either you are inviting someone or someone has invited you. But the last one here may be helpful. You can choose if you want to receive a daily agenda. So if you want to receive a summary at 5 a.m. each morning, you can choose to set this to email and it will send you a summary of what's happening that day. Now, you do have to make these changes for each and every one of your calendars, but the good news is when it comes to your daily agenda, if you select email, it will combine all of it in a single email. So for example, maybe I want an email notification for this calendar and my family calendar. It will only send me one email, but both of those calendar events will be on it. Now, the next step in making sure that you get the most out of Google Calendar is making sure that you know how to share specific calendars with others, whether that's a coworker, whether that's a client, or perhaps another member of your family. So once again, we're going to come up here to the gear icon, and we are going to select settings. And yes, this will be at a calendar by calendar basis. So let's start with family, because that probably makes the most sense, where you might want to share this with a spouse or a child, or maybe just a good family friend. So you're going to have access to all of your settings here, but what we want to do is come down and select share with specific people or specific groups. And you can see at this time, I'm not sharing it with anyone at this particular point in time. I'm going to come down and select add people and groups. And here is where I can start to type in the name or the email address of the people that I want to share it with. I'm just going to use this example account here. And the most important thing that we need to select here is what level of permission we are going to give them. So we've got four options available to us. The first one is to see only free or busy information. In this case, when I'm sharing a family calendar with a family member, I don't think that's going to make much sense because I want them to be able to see exactly what is going on together. This is perhaps a lot more useful if you just want to show when someone can't book you or when you might be busy. So seeing all events, in my particular example, might make the best sense. They'll see everything that I've included in this family calendar. But if it's someone that I trust and I want to give them the ability to add things or change things, here they can make changes to events. That's the third level down. So they can add new things, they can edit things within that calendar. Then lastly, the greatest level of permission that we can give is to allow to make changes and manage sharing. This means that they can add other people to this calendar as well. So this is the highest level of trust. In most cases, you'll probably be choosing one of the middle two options here, see all events, or make changes to events, but I'll let you decide what is best for you. When you're finished selecting the number of people you would like to add and what level of permissions, you can select send, and they will receive an invite to be a part of your particular calendar. Now for step six, we want to take advantage of a feature that is built right into Google Calendar, but many people do not make the best use of, and that is taking advantage of Google Tasks. If you come here to the top right-hand corner of your screen, you can see that you have a toggle to go between Google Tasks and Google Calendar. You may also notice on the Google side panel, you have access to Google Tasks if you want to see your calendar and your task at the exact same time. Now, I want to be clear, I'm not suggesting that you should replace your existing task manager or your task app with Google Tasks. If you're already using something else and it's working for you, that is fantastic. But just keep in mind that Google Tasks also manages all of your reminders. In fact, a little over a year ago, Google Reminders and Tasks merged so that all reminders, if you set up a reminder on your phone or you ask Google to remind you something in the future, it's actually going to create a task right here within Google Tasks. So for example, maybe I want to remind someone of this webinar. I want to make sure that they make it tomorrow. Well, I don't want to create an event because that's going to block off time on my calendar, but I do want to remind them at about 1 p.m. in the afternoon. So I'm going to select that 1 p.m. slot, but instead of creating an event, I'm going to come here and select create a task. And I'm going to say call Jane regarding the webinar, something along those lines. I could add other details such as adding a description. And yes, you can create multiple lists within Google Tasks. I'm going to hit save. Now, this is not blocking off any time. I can still accept a meeting or someone could book me in that particular slot, but I will receive a reminder when it comes to 1 p.m. And the other nice thing about tasks slash reminders is that if I forget to check this off, it will follow me into the next day. So if I get to the end of Thursday and I still haven't completed this, if I still haven't marked it as complete, it will follow me to Friday so I can at least remember to give her a call then. So tasks are a very important tool, something that can be very valuable. Even if you don't want to use it for all of your to-dos and everything that you want to accomplish, start using them for reminders. You'll find that they can benefit you in so many different ways. Last but not least, we get to step number 7, and this is where we want to plan out things a little bit further into the future or in the long term. We've only talked briefly about using all-day events, whether that's a vacation, whether you're taking a sick day, or something else that is significant and perhaps is not tied to a particular time during the day. Well, when it comes to creating and making the best use of all-day events, especially if you want them to stand out, I recommend that you start including emojis as a part of the process. So for example, Christmas is coming up and I want to make sure that I block off time here, but I want it to be easily seen. I want to be able to glance at it in a moment, whether I'm in my week view or if I'm looking at this in my day view. So because I'm going to block off this entire week, I'm going to create a new all-day event. But before I start to type in any text, I'm going to pull up my emoji calendar. And I'm going to find something like a snowflake. I'm going to enter in that snowflake. I'm going to hit space and I'm going to say holiday break, something like that. And let's don't forget, it's going to be the entire week. So I'm going to stretch it out to the 27th and I'm going to hit save. So there's a couple of things here. Yes, it might be obvious that this stretches out the entire week. But remember, if I'm looking at the day view, I'm not going to see multiple days. But having that emoji can really stand out on your calendar. It jumps out at you and it makes it say that this is something different. This is something that is very different than anything else on our calendar. So have a little fun and help you stay organized at the same time by adding emojis to certain key events. Now, I'd love to hear from you next. What are some of your tips or tricks for staying organized here within Google Calendar? Or what was one of your favorite suggestions from today's video? Please be sure to let me know in the comments down below. Thank you so much for watching, and remember, being productive does not need to be difficult. In fact, it's very simple.